We're reading in the 16th chapter of John. Before I start reading, I'm going to bring you up to where we're at. This is after the crowds had left Jesus because they said it's too hard to follow him. This is after the Last Supper. And Judas is in the process of betraying Jesus as he's trying to teach his 11 remaining disciples what to expect from the world and what to expect from the Holy Spirit. And that's what we're going to pick up in chapter 16 of John. Verse number 1. These things have I spoken unto you, that you may not be offended. You don't want them to be upset when they see what's coming against them. He wants them to be prepared. They shall put you out of the synagogue. Yea, the time is coming that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. But the things I have told you, that when the time shall come, ye shall remember that I told you of them. And the things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. He's telling them beforehand that way they'll know it's the truth when they see it. He says, I didn't have to tell you before because I was with you. But he's preparing them for him leaving. But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you ask me, where goest thou? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. Jesus don't want us to be alone. In John 14, he tells them that he don't want them to be orphans. I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm not going to leave you orphans. But in the Greek, what he's telling them in 14 is talking about coming alongside. The Holy Spirit comes alongside Jesus Christ and is going to continue here on earth after Jesus goes to heaven. Nothing that the Holy Spirit tells you is going to contradict the Bible or what he's taught on his earthly ministry. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin, and of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go unto the Father, and ye shall see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. I think sometimes Jesus has to do us that way.
Amen.
He's got a lot of stuff to tell us, but sometimes we can't bear it, and he has to wait a little while. And he told them that they couldn't bear it right now. There in 11, where it says that of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged, that means that Satan has been judged and continues in that state of judgment. Howbeit, when he, the Holy Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear that thou shalt speak, and he will show you things to come, and shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take of mine, and shall show it to you. The Holy Spirit's not going to show us anything that Jesus and the Father had showed him. A little while, and you shall not see me. And again, a little while, and you shall see me, because I go to the Father. A lot of people don't believe that Jesus came and walked on this earth. You know, there's more proof that Jesus Christ lived, died, and resurrected than there is that Julius Caesar ever lived. Your people don't have no problem believing in him. Then said unto his disciples among themselves, What is this that he saith unto us? A little while, and yet ye shall not see me. And again a little while, and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father. And they said, therefore, what is this that he hath saith a little while, and we cannot tell what he saith? Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask him, and said unto them, do you inquire among yourselves the fact that I say it a little while, and you shall see me no more, and again a little while, and you shall see me? Verily, verily, I say unto you, that you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice, and you shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in travail, hath sorrow, because her hour is come. This is Jesus' hour. But as soon as she delivereth of the child, she remembered no more pain, no more of the anguish, for the joy that a man is born into the world. The woman forgets real quick about the pain of childbirth as soon as she sees her baby. And Jesus is saying, when I come to my Father's glory, I'm going to forget about this pain and suffering that I had to go through, for the glory of getting to see all the people that will be drawn unto me. And ye now, therefore, have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice. And your joy no more taketh from me, and your joy no man taketh from me, from you. I get it out. And in that day ye shall ask me nothing. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Hereunto have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. He wants us to be full of joy. He wants us to be filled with his Holy Spirit. These things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs, but the time cometh when I shall no more speak to you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly the Father. At that day you shall ask of my name, you shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you, that I will pray the Father for you, for the Father himself loveth you, because you have loved me, and have believed that I am come out from God. I come forth from the Father, and am cometh unto the world again. I leave the world and go to the Father. The disciples said unto him, lo, now speakest thou plainly, and speakest no proverb. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. But this we believe, that thou comest forth from God. You would think that would make Jesus happy when he hears him say, now we believe, now we know that you come from the Father. But Jesus answers him, do you now believe? Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things I have spoken unto you, that you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. He's teaching them a hard lesson. He's teaching them the cost of following Jesus. If you follow Jesus, you're going to be different. If you follow Jesus, the world's going to persecute you. If you follow Jesus, the world's not going to love you when you're late. The world's full of darkness. And the Bible says that men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. We're all evil. We're all capable of horrible things. The only reason that we're not out doing horrible things is because of Jesus' Holy Spirit that he's left for us. And it's not that the Holy Spirit never worked in the Old Testament, but in the Old Testament, it wasn't dwelling within us. It says there was not many open visions in the Old Testament. He would come to people like Abraham to tell him, I am. He would come to different people like he's taught this morning. Come to Jacob. And I'm going to change your name. I'm going to make you respectable. But in the New Testament, he promises an indwelling of the Holy Spirit. It can come and take up abode in your heart and in your life. That way, everywhere you go, he's with you. You're never alone. Just like Jesus says, you know, even though y'all leave me, I'm not alone because I and the Father are one. And that's what he's called the Holy Spirit to do. He calls him a name. He says, him. He don't refer to it as an object. He's referring to it as him. He says, he will open up the truth unto you. He'll let you know after I'm gone what you need to know. He'll bring remembrance unto you. That way that they could write this book that we study called the Bible, the New Testament. Because he gave them the Holy Spirit to guide them. The cross death didn't result in us having less of Jesus. The cross death resulted in us having a much greater indwelling of the Holy Spirit because of what he did for us.
Amen.
You know, the question is the Holy Spirit filling you? You know, when you're saved, you get all the Holy Spirit you're going to get. You can't get no more of it. But does the Holy Spirit have all of you? Or does he just have 5%? 10%, maybe even 99%. The Bible says 99% ain't enough. He wants all of it. That's what he's called us to do, to lose our life for him. That it's all or nothing. We either live every day for him or every day against him. When they picked corn in the Old Testament on the Sabbath, and the religious leaders wanted to come against him and say, what are you doing? Won't you tell your disciples not to be doing that? Jesus says, you either live every day for me or every day against me. If they were hungry, leave them alone. Some people want to take that and the ox and the ditch and make that as an excuse to work, but the Bible says that the Sabbath was created that way man could have rest. Man wasn't created for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was created for man. And from time to time, Jesus would pull himself aside and go up on the mountain to be alone. But sometimes we have to come apart and pray and study. That way we don't come apart. But that don't give us any excuse to lay down and quit. But just like Jesus would have the disciples, and he says there were so many of them flocking them and upon them, and he was healing so many, at one time they didn't even have time to eat, didn't do anything. He told them, let's come apart for a few minutes. Let's come over here. Sometimes we have to do that to get our strength back. But the world wants to push us and push us and push us. If we're not letting the Holy Spirit indwell us, if we're not letting the Holy Spirit guide us, the world will get us in such a shape that we're not able to follow him and we'll be miserable. And Paul says, of all men, a Christian would be the most miserable if this was the only life that we had. But it's not because of the things we're going through, it's because of Paul says, the things I want to do, I don't do. And the things I don't want to do, I do. We get persecuted. But that ain't what Paul was talking about. Paul was talking about sin. He didn't want to sin, but he did. And because of sin, there comes punishment. But because of Jesus, there comes forgiveness and mercy. Not that we deserve it, but because he loved us. I have a little story, and this is from a pastor in a church in our community. He said it was a hot summer day, and he had been praying that the Holy Spirit would speak to him, that he would hear the Holy Spirit better. He said it was on a Friday, and he'd been riding his horses, and said he needed to go down to the co-op and get something. And he had a man in his church whose brother was handicapped. And he had just moved out of state and moved there, and he was lost. And the man in his church asked him, he says, will you go by and talk to my brother sometime? And he told him he would. But this so happens, on his way to the co-op, he passed the guy's house, and he was sitting outside in a wheelchair on the sidewalk. And the Holy Spirit told him to stop. He says, Lord, this is my only day off. Friday's the only day that I set aside for myself. I'll stop tomorrow. And he kept going. As you expect, the Holy Spirit really convicted him. Haven't you been praying that I would speak to you, that you could hear me better? So he stops and he turns around and he goes back. When he gets back, the man's still sitting there in the same place on the sidewalk. And he gets out and he walks up there. It's a hot summer day. That man had slid off the edge of the sidewalk and was stuck. He'd been sitting there for hours and couldn't move. And he confessed that the Holy Spirit told me to stop and I kept going. But he convicted me to where I had to come back. He said, what if I hadn't come back? What if he'd sit there all day in that heat with no help? He got to talk to him. He took him inside, got him a drink of water. The guy wasn't saved right then, but he started coming to his church. Several months later, he did get saved. How many times do we do the same thing when the Holy Spirit touches us? Just knocks on our heart and whispers to us to do something. He said, I will do it later. Later may be too late. We need to be obedient when the Spirit talks. But then on the other hand, there's people that use the Holy Spirit to say, the Lord told me to do this. And anything that contradicts the Bible, the Holy Spirit didn't tell you to do it. If the Lord tells you to do something, or the Holy Spirit tells you to do something, you pick up your Bible and read it, and it's a direct contradiction to the Word, you know it ain't the Holy Spirit. The Bible says to try the spirits and see where they come from. Every spirit that speaks is not the Holy Spirit. We need to always back it up with God's Word. God's Word will never lead us astray, and neither will the Holy Spirit. Let's be indwelled with God's Spirit. Let's be encouraged by what He's done for us. He came and lived a sinless life and died on the cross to give us the gift of eternal life, to give us the gift of the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us and direct us. So the Spirit of truth will come and reveal everything to you. And His disciples, after He died, then they understood. But there they said, oh yeah, we understand. Do you now understand? Because you're all fixing to be scattered. You're all fixing to go back to where you come from. Well, Peter says, I'll go fishing. And a lot of them says, well, I'll go with you. How quickly that we'll set aside what we're supposed to be doing just because things don't go our way. He tried to tell them, I'm going away. But they didn't understand. But after the Spirit came and filled them, they understood it. And they knew they were going to be persecuted. They knew that they were going to be put to death, put out of the synagogues, and killed. And people would say that they're doing good by doing it. Before the Holy Spirit came, they were afraid and scattered and running. After the Holy Spirit filled them up and indwelled them, they boldly faced opposition and spoke the truth all the way until their death. No more fear of man because of what God did in their life. You want to come get a song? That's all I have this evening. But if the Holy Spirit's never come into your heart or your life, there's only one way to get it. And that's by asking Jesus into your heart, in your life.